Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Cuckoo's Flight, written by Wendy Orr and read by Roslyn Oades. To Olive and Claudia, Angus and Rose, who will make their own history in a changing world. Author's note. Cuckoo's Flight takes place in the same world as Dragonfly's Song and Swallow's Dance, based on the Minoan civilization of Crete about 4,000 years ago. It was a sophisticated and artistic culture whose ships traded as far away as Cyprus and Egypt, but was eventually overtaken by the Mycenaeans from mainland Greece, probably by a mixture of warfare and assimilation. Although Crete had indigenous horses, the Minoans don't seem to have used them as much as many other Bronze Age societies. However, in a tiny museum in Arkenes in Crete, I saw a Minoan clay figurine of a woman riding a horse. I started wondering about her. At the same time, my sister Catherine was planning a horseback trip through Mongolia. Her travels reignited my dreams of the joy and freedom of riding, even though an accident has left me unable to continue to do so. Partway through the first draft, I realised that my protagonist Clio was disabled and like me, and could no longer ride. The later drafts of this book were written during the pandemic and lockdown. In many ways, we returned to an earlier time. Our family became a multi-generational household, afraid of an uncertain future and a disease that appeared to have no cure. All these factors made Cuckoo's Flight a slightly different book than it would have been otherwise. I finished the book without seeing the end of the pandemic, but in life as in fiction, I remain hopeful for the future. If she had stayed to load the kiln, as she should have, she'd never have seen the ship. Mama said the ship would still have been there, so everything had to happen the way it did. But that's not true. Clio saw it, and the world changed. 1. The Black Ship in Winter. Selena's rules are strict. Never, never trust anyone else with our pots. We load them into the kiln ourselves and we take them out ourselves. And though Clio has to trust Head and Tail, the carrier twins, to take them from workshop to kiln, it's her job to follow the palanquin tray and check that nothing is damaged when it arrives. The twins lower the poles to the ground, smoothly as reflections in a mirror. They stoop again to lift the inner tray out onto a raised rock slab. Clio swings around it, keeping her crutch well out of the way. All the little figurines are upright and perfect.
Goddess, thank you, she says, hand on her heart. Tail passes her a soft clay tablet, and she stamps it with her grandmother's seal stone, hanging from a cord around her wrist. But the kiln's lid is off and Delia is reaching in, just starting to take her own pots out.
We can't wait for you to unload today, a twin says to Delia. It has to be Head because Tail never speaks. We've got a load of spearheads for the palace from Eagle the Bronze. We'll be back for your pots when we're done.
Delia and Clio try not to smile. They can fit more talk into firing a kiln than anyone would believe. But an excuse to take a little longer is a gift from the gods, especially when Delia is bursting to finish the whispered story she started at the end of the dawn ceremony about the priest girl who wants to marry a fisher boy. And how would the lady ever let her do that?
Though he's a pretty enough fisher to be descended from the sea god, and surely that's good enough even for priest folk.
Clio giggles. She wants to hear the story, and even more than that, she wants to simply be here with Delia, away from her family in the workshop. Sometimes it seems they understand each other as easily as the carrier twins.
But just as her friend is whispering about the fish's secret visit to the palace, Clio feels a sudden tug at her heart, sharp as a jab of physical pain. The laughter dies in her throat. Grey girl! Her mare, dapple the colour of the morning sea, is heavy with foal.
Any day now,
Dada said yesterday, though it's earlier in the year than it should be, closer to winter than spring, and the rain is cold. Even if the grandmothers are right that winters aren't as cold or wet as they used to be, there's still enough ice in the air to chill a newborn foal. And her father will be busy all day in the ship sheds. He and Uncle Doulos want to finish repairing the hull and aren't even coming home for siesta. It'll be too late if Grey Girl is in trouble.
You look like a mother with a sick babe, says Delia. Go. He won't be calm till you've seen her. I'll load your pots and start firing the kiln when I'm finished unpacking mine.
We can't do that.
It's true that for the last 2 years, Delia has often helped her, because Clio needs to put her crutch down to lift the pots from the rock slab into the top of the kiln. She can balance on her stiff leg for a moment, though she's dropped more than one pot when she wobbles. What hurts more than the pain itself is needing the help. It's the one thing she can never tell Delia. But helping is different from doing. And these are the goddess figurines, the specialty of her grandmother's workshop, not everyday cups or bowls. If Mama ever finds out...
I'll be as careful as if they were my own, says her friend. Selena will never know. I'll be waiting a while for the twins anyway.
But you never know when I'll need a favour in return.
A big one, says Clio, wavering.
A huge one,
Delia agrees. Clio is already swinging her way out to the river road, her crutch taking its giant strides and her stiff right leg lagging behind. Grey girl, misty as the morning sea, dappled like a pebbled beach, her heart beating with Clio's since they were raised, girl and foal on the milk of the mare when Clio's mother had none. Dada tells of lifting a babe too young to stand to the foal's back so they could learn each other's warmth, and by the time they were two, they moved as one. Mama, always afraid, saying that horses, wild as stags in the hills, had no place in their lives, but couldn't forbid, because Dada's gods say they're the heart of his. Clio wishes the goddess would say the same for her, but the great mother stays silent, except in the link she forged between horse and girl, so that even that day, when a snake wriggled out from a rock through the mare's front legs, so she shied and reared, throwing Clio hard to her knees, the left on the ground, the right onto the rock, pain spearing into her hip, so fierce she thought she would die, her mind closing in blackness. Grey girl wouldn't let her drown in that dark, wouldn't leave her side, standing guard on the path, trumpeting a neigh of terror till Petros the herder came, and then Dada, running all the way from town and carrying Clio home as if she were a babe. She remembers Grey Girl's call and seeing Dada's face drain to the colour of ash, but nothing of the moon that followed till she heard Mama weeping.
Three daughters I've lost so far. Can the great mother not leave me one?
And her grandmother's voice, calm and sure.
The girl will live. Her life will not be the one we planned. But when life changes, so must we. And she is strong enough to do that.
Clio opened her eyes, returned to life, and her leg did its best to heal. By winter, she could stand for a moment or two. Hector carved a crutch. Now she can walk, nearly as fast as a run, but the twisted leg will not turn or grip the side of a horse. She cannot ride. Mama says that the snake, the great mother's beast, was clearly saying it was well past time for Clio, an almost woman, to forget her horses and turn her thoughts to her trade.
But Clio says her horse, born of the sea god, showed respect for the Great Mother's snake, saved her life, and earned her gratitude. They could argue about it all day, and sometimes do. Dada never argues the ways of the goddess, but began to build a chariot, like the ones from his home, the harness first, so that long before the chariot was done, Grey Girl could begin to learn the feel of this new skill. Soft goat leather, stitched strong over evenings into spring, always out of Mama's sight, for bridle, reins, chest band, and girth. Returning from the sea in autumn, with fittings of bronze, Mama, so glad to see him safe and home she couldn't complain, shaped the poles, built six-spoked wheels for strength. Like a war chariot, he said, made to bounce over the roughest ground. Though I hope my child will never need to go to war. But the body has taken the longest of all, weaving basket after basket, models for a doll who cannot stand as a warrior does, but must sit still with her legs tucked safe. The kilns are on the northwest corner of town, just outside the wall. In front of them, the road to the sea winds between the barley field and the olive grove. On the left is the river road. Cleo follows it to just before the washing rocks by the bridge, onto the smaller track to Grey Girl's Valley. Grey Girl's mother was a filly in her second summer when Hector arrived as a frightened fugitive on Uncle Doulos's ship. He saw wild horses as they came into the bay and knew that he could make a new life in this land. It was the first time he'd smiled since he punched a man for beating his horse back home in Troy. He never tells the end of that story. All Cleo knows for sure is that the young man who became her Dada fled to the sea and begged sanctuary from the captain of the first ship he saw. That captain was her mother's brother. So, even before Selena married him, Cleo's father had captured a filly, cared for her, and taught her to come to his whistle. He made a bridle of goat leather, and at the end of her third summer, when he came home from the trading season, trained her to carry him on her back. After a while, when she tried to return to the wild herd she came from, the lead mare drove her away, though the stallion came down to visit her in the spring. She grew fat with a foal the second year, and the foal, when it was born, was fat and healthy too. But one morning, when Hector whistled for them, the mare came alone, ears laid back in fright, deep scratches on her legs and belly. He doesn't know what took the foal, wolves or wild dogs or even shepherds jealous of the grass it ate, but he never saw a trace of it again. Most of the foals after that survived, but found wild herds once they were grown. Until 3 years ago, when Hector hired a family of goat herds to run the horses with their goats. The horses don't like the dogs, and if the horses go a different way to the flock, the herders must choose their own goats, but they watch over them all as best they can. The old mare died foaling last spring, so now there's just Grey Girl, her two-year-old filly Fleetfoot, and the old mare's colt. He's coming into his third spring, but he's still called Colty because he's the last foal born. Although Cleo and her father say the horses are theirs, the truth is, even with Petros and his dogs guarding them, Grey Girl could lead her herd to freedom if she wanted. Cleo sometimes thinks it's they who belong to the horses. The giant vultures are wheeling high above now, scanning the ground for rotting flesh. And Cleo's memory of the old mare's death turns into a vision of Grey Girl on the ground. Grey Girl lying alone, stranded and straining. The thought pulls her down the path faster than she's ever gone before, her crutch thumping through prickly bushes that scratch her leather apron and catch at her sheepskin cloak. She can't see any of the horses, or the goats, or their herder. At the top of the riverbank, she stops long enough to catch her breath and whistle. A cuckoo's call, one long, one short. It's always brought Grey Girl from wherever she is, if she can walk. The mare trots gently up the hill, her round belly swinging. The scent of trampled thyme reassures Clio before she sees her. Now soft lips are nuzzling the girl's face, whiskers tickling. Clio drops her crutch to stroke the mare's forehead, rub between her ears the way she loves, before running her hands over the round sides and belly. Everything feels normal. "Thank you," she says to the great mother and god of horses. Her right hand is on her heart in prayer, but she keeps her left on Grey Girl's face to remind the gods who the thanks are for and from. The colt and filly prance up but lose interest quickly when they see she hasn't picked anything for them. "Next time," she promises, though only Grey Girl's ears twitch as if she understands. Clio buries her face against the warmth of the strong grey neck. She knows she ought to hurry back to the kiln. But I was so sure she needed me. What was that heart prickle, if not Grey Girl's call? As if in answer, the mare nudges her shoulder. It's been 2 years now, but sometimes she forgets that her girl can't ride anymore. "Even if I could," Clio tells her, "you're too near your time." Grey Girl nudges again, and when Clio still refuses, starts up the hill. Hector says that mares are often restless before they foal. Is she searching for a safe place now? Clio wonders. Is that why I felt her calling? She grabs her crutch again and follows. The mare ambles up the hill to the ridge overlooking the river. The vultures have moved on, but eagles circle lazily in the winter sky. Further back towards town, Clio can see the goats grazing near the herder's hut. The tune of a flute wafts gently over the breeze. At the top of the ridge, Grey Girl stops and sniffs the wind. On flat ground, the mare's shoulder is just above the girl's chin. But here, on the steep side of a hill, Grey Girl's back is level with her chest. It's almost overwhelmingly tempting to pull herself up, swing her left leg over and sit there, just for a moment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.